Well, good evening, everyone. I was really pleased to ask to come here tonight to talk about Canon Will. And I was thinking about what knowledge could I impart on you? What could I tell you about the various different degrees of my career? And I thought perhaps the most interesting part was the start. And it sort of all started for me in 1993 when I saw a little advert in the Financial Times newspaper. And this advert said football club for sale. I thought, that's interesting. So I phoned up, I got the details. I went to my chairman at the time and I said, let's buy this football club, I'll go and run it. He said, football, Karen? He said, very male dominated. You'll have to be twice as good as the men to be thought as even only half as good. I said, well, luckily that's not difficult. He said, go on then, we'll give it a go. And that was on the Friday, and on the Monday, we owned a football club. And I remember at the time, I was 23 years old, and I was going to meet the press, about 200 press, and I was desperate to look at least 25. So I turned up, big hair, big shoulder pads, big earrings, and I had this really serious presentation of all these things I was going to do in my football club. And I stood up in front of the press, and I did this very serious presentation. And when I'd finished, I said to the press, any questions? A little hand went up. And I said, yes, sir. He said, Sunday people. I said, yes, sir. He said, what are your vital statistics? I thought, here we go. I said, look, I know it's hard for you to think of a woman and a young woman at that coming here to run this football club. I said, but you trust me, you're going to come back here in 10 years' time and you're going to see my football club playing in the best league in the world and I'm going to set the standards that other football clubs are going to follow. And with that, it's very dramatic, I flipped my very big hair and as I walked off the stage past the journalist, he said to me, and this is no word of a lie, he said to me, well, you ain't got a dick, but you have got great big balls. And it's absolutely true, I don't have to hick. but I probably do have great big balls, which is probably where the Canon Will comes in. And it's interesting that my prediction to that journalist probably came true more like 12 years later, where my football club was voted by Deloitte as the blueprint of running a successful business, a successful football club across Europe. And I sold that football club in 2009, from its humble beginnings, I sold it for £82 million. And that's part of the journey, really, that I wanted to talk about tonight, very briefly, about how do you take something under difficult circumstances that's falling down, that's run down, that's on the verge of collapse, who were in administration, and turn it into a company that is not only profitable, that's not only recognized as best practice, but one that has integrity, one that does things the right way, that has great culture, because one of the hardest things to change in any business is culture, and it's the most important thing. And make it something that people are proud to be associated with, and something that's worth worth money, and brands are worth money. And to sort of, I want to sort of take you back to what I had inherited, what I had bought in 1993. I'd bought this football club, run down, falling down. It had run out of money, it had no cash. So everything in the football club, every service, every product, everything they needed, they had to contra, because they didn't have any cash to buy it. So for example, someone would phone up and they'd say, fix our typewriter, we'll give you a season ticket. And when I arrived, they gave me this big folder that they called the Contra Bible. And in it was every contra deal they'd ever done. You'd have seen the deals they'd done with the milkman, but anyway. When I looked at this list, somebody had made a decision at the football club to swap an executive box for black bin bags. Now, that was a man, but we'll carry on. And there was no roof on the toilet block. You stood down, you stood on the cop as it was. It wasn't the award-winning stadium I finished it with. It was almost all standing. And you looked down and there was this toilet block and the roof had blown off. So you had the great pleasure of seeing people going to the toilet on a match day. And I remember at the time thinking, well, not much happening on the pitch. At least it's something mildly entertaining. One has to be positive. And I came across a business practice in 93 that thank God I've never come across again. and it was the business practice that they called in-departmental invoicing. And I remember discovering it in the program department. And they were selling, about 60% of the people in the ground were buying a program, and in those days that was a really high average. So I got the program guy in. I said, 60% of people buying a program, that's excellent. I said, tell me though, what are all these invoices? Oh, he said, those are my in-departmental invoices. I said, what does that mean? Oh, he said, those are the invoices that I give to the commercial department for the programs they give away free to the corporate hospitality guests. I said, well, why on earth do you do that? Oh, he said, makes my figures look good. Well, he left. There was no drive, there was no ambition in this business. There was no realization actually it was a business. The chief scout was also the catering manager. And they had no computers. Absolutely everything was done by hand, everything, including wages. And on my first Wednesday, which is traditionally the day off for the footballers at a football club, I come into the office and I see all the staff, the manager, the players, the tea lady, the admin staff, all queuing up the stairs of the offices to the accounts office, which had a stable door. And the top half was open and the accounts lady stood behind it. And in front stood the players or whatever. And they would be handed little brown envelopes with their names written very neatly on the top. And inside was cash or check, depending on how much they earned. And I remember walking up the stairs, and I think it was the first time I realized the enormity of the job that I had to do. And I walked up the stairs, and as I walked up the stairs, one of my young players, Graham Potter, he stopped me and said, I'm sorry to bother you. He said, but I haven't had my sign-on fee, because in addition to weekly wages, players get sign-on fees. I said, okay. I said, I'll go and find out what's happened. So I go into accounts, and I said, Graham Potter hasn't had his sign-on fee. Can anybody tell me why that is? The lady says, I'll get the cash book. And off she rummages. She gets this great big red cash book. She flicks through to the P's, and she went, oh, look. I put it in the wrong line, and I paid it to Porter. And I remember realizing at that moment that in life, there are people who make things happen. There are those that watch what happens. And then there are those that wonder what happened. And we were in that third category. And it was really a case of having to be dedicated to change this business into something credible, to change it into something worthwhile, to set a strategy. And that's about really good leadership. And really good leadership in any field, to me, is about hearts and minds. And the minds part is all about communication. If you go into any business of mine, people will tell you, everyone will be able to tell you, from the lowest person, the intern, to the highest person, where we're going, how we're going to get there, what their individual role is in that journey, and what is their reward if the company's successful and they're successful. Everybody can tell you what we stand for, why we do things, what things are important to us. And those are the things that you do through communication. The worst kind of business I think to work in is one without any expectation. I want everybody to have expectation in my business. And the hearts part, in some respects, is almost even more important. To go into a job that you're respected, where you're trusted, where you're nurtured, where you're mentored, where you can be the best you can be, I think is the most wonderful place to work. And I remember when I was 18 and I left school, I left with only something called my core values. I had determination, I had an idea of what I wanted to do, and I didn't know how I was going to do it. So I thought to myself, what kind of people do I want to surround myself with? What kind of environment do I want to work in? And if I'm successful, what kind of business person would I like to be? And when I had the opportunity to set up my own business, I wanted it to be the kind of business that I wanted to work in when I was 18. The kind of business where I would be the best I can be and be respected for that. And nothing in that business would alter what I thought, how I thought. It would just embrace everybody without politics. And I think having looked around at the various businesses I've run, the various business people that I've worked with, the final thing I wanted to talk to you about can and will was what I think are the six really key ingredients to being a successful business person. Most of us can only manage one or two, but I've been fortunate enough to work with people that have all six. And the first one of those things is leadership itself. And they say that a real leader faces the music, even if he doesn't like the tune. And what that actually means in business is it doesn't matter how much you know how to do, but how you behave when you don't know what to do. And a great hero of mine, Martin Luther King, sums up leadership for me with his quote, "The ultimate measure of a man is not where he stands in moments of comfort, but where he stands in times of challenge." And I think anybody in this room who thinks about that tagline, thinks about some of the things they faced, will tell you that attitude and leadership are the key skills, the ability to take on what you don't think you can achieve, the ability to find a way forward. And leadership should never be confused with management. Management is about managing an outcome. Leadership is about inspiring people to achieve what is often thought as the unachievable. The second thing is ambition. Ambition is that spark, fire, inside of people that drives them on. And so very often we get scared of ambitious people because we don't understand it. And I can't tell you how important ambition is, because nobody ever started anything without ambition. It's absolutely true that you won't finish it without a lot of hard work. But I work very closely with Alan Sugar. Alan to me, Lord Sugar to you. And here is a man who has everything. There's no house, car, aeroplane, probably small island somewhere that he doesn't have. But when we're filming, we start very often 5 o'clock in the morning and we don't finish 11 o'clock at night, and that's every day, 7 days a week. He's the first in and the last out. And the ambition, actually, is the driver, because the toughest thing about being a success is that you've got to keep on being a success. And that's about a personal pride. It's not about achieving your aims or being wealthy or having things. It's a personal pride to do your best all of the time. The third thing is determination. If I had to pick something that was key to my own success, it would be determination. The ability to pick myself up when I've been knocked down. And sometimes I think in life that actually being able to find your backbone, grit your teeth, get back up and put one foot in front of the other is the most incredible commodity we have as human beings. The fourth thing is attitude. And I say to my staff all the time, if you don't like something, change it. But if it's not in your power to change, then you have to change your attitude to it. And I have one rule about attitude, how I assess everything, a personal decision, a business decision, and that is that I always ask myself, if I make this decision, if I take this challenge, what is the worst that can happen? And I think in life, if you can protect your downside, if you can come face to face with the worst thing that can happen to you or your business, you assess the risk. You understand the gamble. You measure how determined you are to embrace your attitude to things. The fifth thing is direction. And they say that the whole world steps aside for the man who knows where he is going. And opportunities and direction are always disguised as hard work, so very often a lot of people don't want to see them. And in my business, everybody has to spend time with me to understand, actually, that to run a business, to take on the responsibility for the many people that work for me, takes an enormous amount of passion and commitment and determination and desire and ambition and relentless perseverance and persistence. And that's what breeds culture. Everybody understanding what is expected, what needs to be delivered, and how you start that from the very top. And the last thing, I think, is to be positive. Because true success is largely a part of hanging on when everyone else has let go. And I've got a motto in my life that I've lived my whole life by, from when I first found this motto at 18 to now. Should a lady tell her age? I don't know, 45. And I want to share it with you because it's what I believe in. Nothing in this world can take the place of persistence. Talent will not. Nothing is more common than unsuccessful people with talent. Genius will not. Unrewarded genius is almost a proverb. Persistence and determination alone are important. The slogan, press on, has solved and always will solve the problems of the human race. And as I stop to pass over to Pam, I think, next. Is it Pam? Will. I ask if you can't remember any of that, you remember this because it's equally important. And that is that behind every successful man is a surprised mother-in-law. Have a lovely evening.